The Critical Theory and Rationality in Citizenship Education. In the classical Greek definition of citizenship education, a model of rationality can be recognized that is clearly political, normative, and visionary. Within this model, education was seen as basically political, designed to educate the citizen for intelligent and active participation in the civic community. Citizenship education became entwined in a culture of positivism, one that displayed little interest in the ways in which schools acted as agents of social and cultural reproduction in a society marked by significant inequities in wealth, power, and privilege. This chapter argues that if citizenship education is going to revitalize itself in the interest of creating a decent and just society, it will have to free itself from the burden of its own intellectual and ideological history. It will have to develop a new rationality and problematic for examining the relationship between schools and the wider society. The importance of the notion of rationality becomes clear when its definition is extended to include the concept of the problematic. This concept suggests that any mode of rationality can be viewed as a theoretical framework, the meaning of which can be understood by analyzing both the systems of questions that command the answers given, as well as the absence of those questions that exist beyond the possibility of such framework. Before analyzing the different modes of rationality that dominate citizenship education, let us have a brief description of the rationality that appears to dominate American social science. By focusing on the dominant rationality in American society, it is possible to get a better understanding of the nature of schooling as a societal process. The recognition that schools are agencies of socialization is an assumption shared by all proponents of citizenship education. Socialization process is a process that mediates the social practices and cultural beliefs necessary to maintain the dominance of certain groups and power structures. The dominant rationality as the American ideology is composed of the following elements. Most models of citizenship education can be categorized under what can be termed three modes of rationality, which represent different processes of social inquiry and is determined by specific knowledge interests. First is technical rationality. This uses the natural sciences as its model of theoretical development and rests on a number of assumptions that underlie its view about knowledge, human values, and the organizational nature of social inquiry. The interrelated assumptions, when translated into educational theory and practice, take the following form. First, educational theory should operate in the interests of law-like propositions, which are empirically testable. Second, knowledge, like scientific inquiry, is regarded as value-free. Third, causation in this approach is linked to a notion of prediction that makes the process a linear one. Finally, there is a belief that educators themselves can operate in a value-free manner by separating statements of values from the facts and modes of inquiry. Two traditions in citizenship education that are strongly wedded to the basic assumptions of technocratic rationality include the citizenship transmission. The essence of this model is captured in the concept of transmission. It is fixed and unchanging in the sense that its form, structure, and underlying normative assumptions appear to be universalized beyond the realm of historical contingency or critical analysis. Teachers and students within this context are expected to be either passive consumers or transmitters of knowledge, rather than negotiators of the world in which they work and act. Social science model was heavily influenced by Jerome Bruner's structuralist notion that the essence of learning lies in understanding the basic principles governing the structure of specific academic disciplines. Learning in this approach is based on students mastering the basic ideas and body of knowledge that represent the deep structure of a particular discipline. Advocates of the new social studies placed a number of assumptions that supported their claims to an improved approach to citizenship education. This include a claim to high status knowledge and equality with other academic disciplines, a claim to the truth based upon a view of social science knowledge as correct, support for an epistemology based on reflectionalist notion of learning, in which the mastery of specific social science knowledge and skills would offset the half-truths and mystifications inherent in common sense knowledge, and support for a categorized view of knowledge and a connected view of social relationships. Second, hermeneutic rationality has a deep-seated interest in understanding the communicative and symbolic patterns of interaction that shape individual and intersubjective meaning. This rationality has generated a number of important concerns for educational theory and practice. First, it has challenged many of the common sense assumptions that teachers, students, and other educational workers use to guide, structure, and evaluate their day-to-day pedagogical experiences. Second, it has refocused attention on the normative and political dimensions of teacher-student-classroom relationships. Third, it has established a relationship between epistemology and intentionality on the one hand, and learning and classroom social relationships on the other. Finally, hermeneutic rationality has played a significant role in helping educators unravel the hidden and manifest dimensions of classroom knowledge and classroom relationships. The tradition in citizenship education in the United States that has been influenced by this type of rationality falls under the general label of the reflective inquiry approach. This approach relies heavily upon what has generally been called decision-making in a socio-political context. The third one is emancipatory rationality, which is based upon the principle of critic and action. It is aimed at criticizing that which is restrictive and oppressive, while at the same time supporting action in the service of individual freedom and well-being. Two traditions can be abstracted from this radical mode of pedagogy. Political economy position focuses its attention upon macrostructural relationships and how they interconnect and mediate to produce the class relations in a given society. Culturalists, on the other hand, focus their attention on the experiences of subjects and how notions of consciousness, ideology, and power enter into the way human beings constitute their day-to-day realities. Notes toward a theory of citizenship education. First, it is important to point out that what is put forth in this section does not represent a final program. The focus is on larger comprehensive issues that provide the foundation for establishing a theory of citizenship education that is more adequate than those that presently occupy the field. Changing society, a theory of citizenship education will have to redefine the nature of educational theorizing as it presently exists. That is, citizenship education's own problematic must begin with the question of whether or not this society should be changed in a particular way or be left the way it is. In addition to being committed to building a better society, the next step in developing a notion of citizenship education that focuses on schools will have to address concerns about expanding the theoretical perceptions of teachers and other educational workers. That is, teachers rather than students should represent a starting point for any theory of citizenship education. It is important that teachers situate their own beliefs, values, and practices within a wider context so that their latent meanings can be understood better. This dialectical situating will help illuminate the social and political nature of the structural and ideological constraints that teachers face daily. What is needed then is a more comprehensive theory of totality. To avoid the pitfall of treating schools as if they existed in a political and social vacuum. In concrete pedagogical terms, this means that educators need to situate the school, curriculum, pedagogy, and the role of the teacher within a societal context that reveals both their historical development and the nature of their existing relationship with the dominant rationality. In politics of culture, this is a political task whose purpose is to make educators better informed citizens and more effective agents for transforming the wider society. It also increases the possibility for helping students develop a greater social awareness as well as a concern for social action. The implications this concept has for teachers become clear if the notion of culture as ideological hegemony is qualified. If we translate this insight into specific forms of pedagogy for citizenship education, the following theoretical practices for educators could be developed. School knowledge must be analyzed to determine what degree its form and content represent the unequal presentation of the cultural capital of minorities of class and color. That is, how does classroom knowledge embody modes of language, systems of meaning, and cultural experiences so as to invalidate directly or indirectly other forms of cultural capital. The hidden curriculum in schools refers to those underlying norms, values, and attitudes that are often transmitted silently through the social relations of the school and classroom. Finally, an analysis of power and transformation must be made an integral part of a theory of citizenship education. Teachers must attempt to understand the meaning of the contradictions, dysfunctions, and tensions that exist in both schools and the larger social order. Moreover, they must focus on the underlying conflicts in both schools and society and investigate how this can contribute to a more radical theory of citizenship education. Classroom pedagogy and citizenship education. If citizenship education is to be emancipatory, it must begin with the assumption that its major aim is not to fit students into the existing society. Instead, its primary purpose must be to stimulate their passions, imaginations, and intellects so that they will be moved to challenge the social, political, and economic forces that weigh so heavily upon their lives. In other words, students should be educated to display civic courage. But if the development of civic courage is the bedrock of an emancipatory mode of citizenship education, it will have to rest on a number of pedagogical assumptions and practices that need to be somewhat clarified. First, the active nature of students' participation in the learning process must be stressed. Second, students must be taught critically to think critically. They must learn how to move beyond literal interpretations and fragmented modes of reasoning. Third, the development of a critical mode of reasoning must be used so as to enable students to appropriate their own histories. Fourth, students must learn not only how to clarify values, they must also learn why certain values are indispensable to the reproduction of human life. And last, students must learn about the structural and ideological forces that influence and restrict their lives. So that is all for my report. Thank you for listening, classmates and Dr. Abenes.